putting us all in a good mood. Joining us now in studio are Bruce Kluger, senior associate editor of Playboy magazine, and Estelle Sobel, senior editor of American Woman magazine. We want to welcome you both to Good Day New York. Well, that's an instant turn on, right? So early in the morning. Or what makes a massage so sexy?
I think before you figure out what makes massage sexy is where you're going to be doing the massage. And it's funny, I just got back from Thailand a couple months ago, and I was in Chiang Mai, which is all like the massage capital of the world. Mm-hmm. And I always thought that all massage was sexy, and I learned in Thailand how unsexy sometimes massage can be if they're not massaging you in a sexy way.
So there's a right way and there's a wrong way to do this?
There's a sexy and a right.
Okay.
Actually, the sexy thing about massage is that it's very sensual. It's communication. You're communicating with your partner, telling each other what you like, and touching, caressing. I mean, that's all very intimate and very close, and it makes you feel very loving towards your partner.
Now, the other ways that we had commented on earlier, taking a stroll in the park, certainly maybe not during this cold period that we're experiencing, or just a romantic dinner, are they considered boring?
No, I mean, as long as people are, you know, have communication and feel close to each other, I mean, it's an intimate moment. We have so few moments during the day where we can spend time with somebody we care about that any time spent together can be a very important, happy time.
But if you're talking about what turns men on, I think it's important when you're talking about what turns men on to first figure out what turns women on and then see how it differs from what turns men on. I talk to a lot of men, and there's a basic breakdown. Men are more visually stimulated, and women are intellectually stimulated. Men will talk to you ad nauseum about Sharon Stone's nude scenes in Basic Instinct, for instance. Women will more likely focus on Kevin Costner's very sexy Why I Love Women speech in Bull Durham.
Right,
the sensitive man in Bull Durham. Although some will comment on his nude buns in Dances with Wolves, but that's another whole. But while a woman might get turned on by a romance novel, for example, men would look at Playboy and see the pictures.
Now tell me what's so intriguing about watching those pictures in your magazine.
Well,
I'm not dissing your magazine, obviously.
No. I spoke to a photo editor once, and he said the ideal pictorial is sometimes a striptease, being pictures of women who are clothed, getting undressed, and men will agree that sometimes a woman in a bikini or a woman in lingerie is sexier than nude because it lets their imagination
work. That's the key.
Well,
imagination and creativity,
yes,
right?
What it keys into is the whole feeling of the anticipation. And that's something when people are together for a long time, they lose that after a while. The feeling in the beginning when you had the first date and you're fantasizing about the next one and you're anticipating how the next one's going to go and thinking about him. And that's something that you can really recapture by surprising your mate, doing something creative, imaginative, make an erotic tape and put it, you know, give it to him so he can put it in his
car. But don't you find folks are going to get a little embarrassed about that kind of experience, making an erotic tape? I mean, especially when you talk about putting it in someone's card deck,
well,
for example. I would hate to think that there's going to be an accident on the highway.
No, well, you're gonna want to do it in a way that applies to your relationship already.
Yes, absolutely.
Men are traditionally the pursuers.
Mm-hmm.
Women are traditionally the pursued, and there's a subtext there that therefore men like sex and women don't. And I think a real turn on for a man is a woman who is verbal and dominant and aggressive about the sex, and maybe turn the tables on him, take the pressure off on him.
Now you have go ahead, you were going to say something.
I agree, and sex is really in the mind. I mean, the mind is your biggest sexual organ, so if you can really tantalize your mate, tease them, do things to shock them, surprise them, you know, tattoo a part of your body that, you know, with a washable tattoo.
That's pretty sexy.
Something like that.
Ooh, I like that idea. Now, you have a top five list.
Yes,
let's go over very quickly.
Yes, I took a straw poll and talked to a couple men. Our top five were women in sports cars. Something about that, very powerful. women in boxer shorts and T-shirts. His.
Oh, I like that idea.
Women just out of the shower. Women execs and CEOs.
I don't want to touch that. No, no play on words.
And women reporters who interview magazine editors on live TV about what turns them on. How did that one get there?
Are you talking up to me, Bruce? Okay. We want to thank you both for coming on the show. Ways to turn your lover on. Bruce and Estelle, thank you for coming to Good Day New York. Thank you.
Thank you.
Larry, after a break.
Brides, and women like that can use some advice. Estelle Sobel is here to give us that kind of advice.
Not only has she used the personals herself, she's a senior editor at American Woman magazine, where she has written and edited many articles on the single life and helped create Dial a Dream Date. That's a nationwide personal phone and a letter dating service. Please welcome her to our show today. Come here, you had a question. Estelle, before we get to you, we had a couple of more questions here. This gentleman over here was dying to ask something during the break, and I'm going to let you.
Sure. This question's for Kathy. You said that you joined the tennis club in hopes of meeting a man. What exactly do you do when you go there, or are you the aggressive type and go after your man?
I practice the sport a little bit, so I'm at least competent, and now I find myself really enjoying it and meeting a lot of people.
But you just stick with that love part, right?
Yeah.
Who else had a question? Somebody else over. Oh, there you are. Okay.
Ideally, a relationship is supposed to be the icing on a cake, not the cake itself. And the two women on the left seem that they have the cake, they have their own business. But the two on the right, what makes you think that having a man in your life is going to make any difference? That fulfillment has to come from within. And I know it's easy to say, but that fulfillment really has to come from within, and that love has to come from within first, and then you can have a healthy relationship.
Mm-hmm. That's a real dilemma for me. That's a constant dilemma, because I also believe that at the same time that I'm feeling desperate inside. On the outside, I'm always presenting. My friends are going to be shocked when they see this show, because I present an independent outside, and who needs a man, and anyways, I'm tired of them. But actually, inside, I'm crying inside for a man.
Question.
Yes, I have a question for Jackie. Your sister had talked about her serious relationship and the hassle she went through with that. I just want to know if you had been engaged in any serious relationship, and what, if any, do you think that your profession played negatively or positively toward your relationship?
I have been in long-term relationships that just didn't pan out for certain reasons. I've just happened to pick the wrong men when I'm in long-term relationships. I wouldn't say that they're the wrong men. I'm just not their type. And to make it a little bit more broader, I have the tendency to pick gay men.
Wow! Wait a minute! Another talk show here!
So,
how do you pick gay men?
I don't pick them. They come to me. I don't pick them, I swear.
And I can testify.
Okay?
And they come to you and they're serious about a relationship?
They're serious about a relationship, and then usually about 2 weeks or a month into a relationship, they'll go, Jackie, now that I've met you, I'm so comfortable with myself, I can explore my other side, and I can do and be what I want to be. It has happened to me on more than one occasion, trust me, but it doesn't make me love them any less. Most of them are all of them are still friends of mine, and it's just something that happens. I have no idea why. It might be the business that I'm in. I also work as an actress and a singer, so I'm in the club, so that happens. But I also, my sister and I own a restaurant, so it just, I don't know why it happens. I'll be on a train, I don't know. It just happens.
Aside from your concerns about meeting a man, getting married, shouldn't another major concern in your mind be having children? I mean, why you want to get married.
That's why
by the time you're 30.
That was my thing.
I haven't heard anybody mention that or even
their biological clock.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, I said that. I did say that. I said that I wanted to be married by the time I was 30, enjoy my husband, and then have children. By around the time that I was 32.
That's what the age factor is all about. You know, mm-hmm. When you're starting to hit 30, you want to go ahead and you want to have children, you want to have that family, you want to get moving on the whole thing.
You're right.
Well, my clock battery ran down. I have a son who's 23, and I've done that. Actually, I wouldn't mind having another family, but I wouldn't want to have another child myself.
Okay. Estelle, jump in here, lady. We need you. Okay. Is there hope for these ladies?
Yes, there is. First of all, the old survey, the Harvard University survey that came out that said women over 30 have a 20% chance of getting married and women over 40 have about a 1% chance of getting married, is absolutely inaccurate and untrue. Women over 30 have about a 56 to 60% chance and women over 40 have about a 20% chance. Okay. Now that's the statistics. Next, there are, so that should make you feel a little bit relieved. All right, that's the first thing. Next, there are plenty of men out there, and there are plenty of ways to find them and to meet them. But I'd like to start by saying one thing. You have to be comfortable with who you are. Mm-hmm. Now, this is especially for Susan and Kathy. If you're going to meet a man, And already you're putting this kind of expectation on the guy that you're going to meet. If he at all fits any of your criteria, he's right away marriage material in a big, big way. You're starting planning the wedding.
Wait, now before you continue, we'll be right back. We got to take a break. Continue with that. Alina, I was just talking to Alina here. She's the lady who made some of these wonderful dresses. And you say that Jackie was in there designing her dress when she doesn't even have the husband yet?
Yes. We sold gowns to girls who don't have husbands.
You are kidding me.
She didn't sell it to me.
Not husbands. I had a girl come in 3 years, and she fell in love with a gown that was in my window. And I didn't want to push the sale because styles change, tastes change, and I really tried to talk her out of buying the gown. She loved it. She used to come in with a little $20 every week. She met a man. She is now married 3 years. She never fell out of love with her gown. Thank God for that.
Does that sound sad to y'all?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Yeah. That's like, get a life, honey.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yes, that's a very important point, actually.
Come on.
The point to get a life, that is very important. Because in order to meet the right person, you have to be happy with who you are and what you've achieved in life and what you've done. And then you'll project out your happiness and the right person. You know, you can go and try and meet the right person in different ways, but that person will pick up on your feelings because you are... What you attract is what you are. If you don't trust men, you're going to meet untrustworthy men. If you're angry about men, you're going to meet angry men.
Now, what do you say to Jackie?
I think you're a little angry about men.
But you were, right before the break, you were saying some important things over here to Susan.
Yes.
Continue that conversation.
All right. Well, I was telling Susan and Kathy that if they're doing all this and building up the man to such a high proportion on their first date, I mean, what kind of level of expectation, what kind of pressure does that put on the man to really fulfill? And even if you don't say it, he feels it. Believe me, he feels it. He knows that your thoughts and your mind and your soul is occupied with him. And that's something that possibly if you started, if you, you know, held back a little bit and weren't so desperate and wanted to see how he fits your needs rather than how your sewing and your cooking and your quilt making and everything can fulfill him, then you really might be able to learn a little bit about the man and his character. And if he's somebody that you can really start planning a life with rather than planning a life from day one with him.
So what you're saying, yeah, that's true. So what you're saying is oftentimes we'll see somebody we really like, and we're so busy putting them in a spot that we don't let the relationship happen.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Jory?
Actually, I think that it should be like a puzzle. We should be a part of the puzzle. Our puzzle should be pretty much cemented, and then the man of our life should come in and fit inside the puzzle. And if he doesn't fit inside the puzzle along with us, then it's...
You need a new piece.
Then you need a new piece. Piece. You know, you had something to say.
Yeah. Yes, Estelle?
Yeah.
You said there's plenty of men out there.
Yeah.
Where are they?
Now, I'll answer that right after this.
Okay.
America are waiting to hear us tell, where do you find guys these days?
Okay, first of all, as much as there are women out there who want to get married, want to have a family, there are men out there. There are absolutely men out there. That's one of the reasons we created Dial a Dream Date at American Woman Magazine. We have tons of men who want to meet women. They're marriage-minded men. So there are also other ways to meet men. I mean, there's there's also... continuing education classes. The key, I think, and the most important thing to remember is to go with where your interests lie. Start and try to focus on your personal growth as a person. If there's something you want to learn, a skill, something to add to your life. This is something that you could do it, and you'll be enriching yourself. And in the process, you might meet a guy. I mean, there's nothing wrong with doing something to help yourself. And then if you meet someone, that's the icing on the cake. But I wouldn't recommend a woman to go and take a finance course if she hates finance, you know, because she might not meet a guy, and then she'll be mad, and she'll be disappointed that she took the course in the first place.
This gentleman had a good question. Go on.
Well, this is for all of the panel, and how do you know when you meet a man if he's really interested in getting married, rather than just flirting or circulating or being important or something? Really interested.
You ask him.
Yeah, we ask.
Yes, I'm asking.
You ask.
Yeah. How do you know?
I don't ask him because I don't seem to meet him. So.
If we ask on the first date and you know we're going out to dinner, I say, well, you know, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? Or what are your expectations? And they usually talk about their business and their financial situation. And I say, well, what about family? And if they say, well, I don't want to ever be married or I don't want children, I find it difficult to go out with that person.
Can I pay the bill now?
Okay. Excuse me, we've been hearing a lot about marriage, and not enough about love, understanding, and communication. Mm-hmm. Do you have any plans for your life in the event that you don't get married?
Continue as I'm doing.
We do. I know I can say for the two of us that we do. Like I said, we own a restaurant, and we have a very strong family background. My mother teaches self-esteem, so that has a lot to do with the way that we present ourselves. I don't think that we ever go out and present ourselves as, you know, like on the, you know, I would never like go, so on the first date, do you like children? Do you want to do this? I wouldn't do that. That's just not my style.
You wait till the second date.
Yeah, I wait till the second date. Usually if I'm out, usually for me in the experiences that I've had in the last 5 years is I usually ask anybody but one question, are you or have you ever had any homosexual tendencies? But so that's just something personal for me. But, you know, I have to get it out of the way because I've just had this bad luck. But I want love and I want security and I want romance and I want children and I want family. My parents have been married, God bless them, for 43 years, 44 this April.
Cheers for that.
So I believe in long term, and I believe in the day I say I do, before God, my friends, and my family, it will be for life and to build a life together with a man.
All right.
Question.
Well, it's more of a comment than a question. I don't understand how on the first date you can ask a man, where do you see yourself in 5 years? I mean, it's a date, it's not a job interview. I mean, if somebody asked me that on the first date, I'd run for the hills. I'd be like, what does he want to know that for? Like, can't we just enjoy the evening, see what happens, see what develops, and just take it one day at a time, not planning your life 5 years from now. Who knows what's going to happen?
Yeah, Estelle, is that pouncing on somebody?
No, actually, it's not. It's not a bad idea. If you're going to ask these type of questions, it's much easier to do it on the first date when you don't really know him and the pressure's not really on than if you've gone out with him 8 times and then you start asking the questions. So, do you want to get married?
Right.
So, what do you want to do 5 years from now? Then the pressure's on the guy. In the beginning, you're just talking, you know, so what are you doing? What are you doing with your career? Where do you want to be? I mean, that's perfectly fine. That's exploration, getting to know a person.
And they say guys love talking about themselves.
Absolutely. Get them to talk about themselves. You want to find out information. What you are information seekers on a date.
And we're going to seek more information right after this. We'll be back. Husbands. Estelle, you started talking about some of the ways that we can, some of the places you can go and meet some really nice guys, and
okay.
Where?
The point is you have to think creatively. It's just like looking for a job. It takes one job, but you want to get a lot of interviews in the process. Mm-hmm. So look at it that way. There are many places. So some creative ways of doing it are go to the auto shows. Go, you know, call up the Convention and Visitors Bureau in your town and find out when the conventions are of the interesting types of men you want to meet. Go to the motorcycle shows, the auto shows, the boat shows. Why not? There are tons of men there. Find the type of guy, go to the boat that you think the type of guy that you're looking for is going to be at.
And just lay across it in a bikini.
Why not? And, you know, there's nothing wrong. Find, like, Cheers. Find a restaurant that you like to go to. Go there every single Friday night with your girlfriends. Why not? You'll become a regular. People tend to relax when they feel more comfortable with themselves. You'll feel more comfortable if you've been to the same place, you know, five times in, you know, 5 weeks in a row. Other things you can do, join some sort of volunteer group and get on the planning committee. This way you can plan fundraisers, and once you're planning something, you know, then you're involved with the guest list. Then you're involved with calling people up, and you're schmoozing a little bit on the phone, and you're talking to people, and then you're standing at the door. I mean, these are creative ways that everyone can think of to meet people.
Do you have excuses to call them?
Absolutely.
Yes, I would like to know if she's married, and where is she getting her information from?
Estelle?
Well, Estelle, let's get into your personal life there. Go on.
I'm single, but I have an active social life, and I have a very positive attitude. I get a lot of my information from my experiences and from our readers of the magazine who write with their problems, and I really see what's out there and what we can do to change it.
We as women often have a tendency to give up ourselves for a man to make them believe that we're someone that we might not necessarily be. For instance, the lady on the right, you're a tennis player now.
Yes, Kathy,
I'm sorry, Kathy. I think that the key is to play tennis for yourself. And, you know, if a guy should come along, then that's great. But when we're in a long relationship, we seem to give up the tennis and just try to hold on to the guy.
So what you're saying is just be happy within yourself, enjoy yourself, and then you'll automatically attract somebody great. I want you to meet another lady in our audience. Come on, Maria. This is Maria Torres. You have been struggling through the single life yourself. Now tell me about that a little bit.
Well, not quite single. I do have a boyfriend, and I've been dating him for 5.5 years. I'm just wondering what's taking him so long to make that big commitment.
And I hear you've been pressuring him a little bit there too, Maria.
Yes, I've been pressuring him, and I believe about 3 years ago on Christmas, I was expecting a diamond ring, and all I got was like a turquoise ring, and I was very disappointed.
I understand that there is someone special in your life, as you've explained. What is his name?
Roger Falkowitz.
Okay. Here's how he described your growing love.
Maria, when we first met, it didn't take long for me to discover how genuine, warm, and caring you are. You must have known how much I loved you when we bought a new home for us and the three children to live in as a family. Remember Valentine's Day last year when we were in this wedding and I said I wasn't quite ready for marriage? Well, Maria, a man can change his mind.
Maria, that someone is special is here today, and I think he has something to say to you. Roger, where are you? Oh, she's boohooing here.
Oh. We've been together for 5.5 years now, and I know that we've been getting along great, and I know how much it's important to us both to be together. And so in front of everyone, your mom and my family and everyone, if you agree, I'd like you to marry me.
Yay!
Hold on.
We'll be right back.
Questions. Very good answer, Jacqueline. Very good answer. We'll see if your husband matches up with that in a second. Okay, Marge.
Could it be my figure?
Well, that's not exactly what he said. Let me see. I think the exact words were a body that wouldn't quit. Judges? All right, that's a correct answer. You've got another one. Come on up here, Marge, and bring.
Just count for double the points, so a correct answer, anybody can win. Here we go. Ladies, we're going to start with you. Are you ready? Here we go. Okay, Jacqueline, here's the question. We're going to start with you. What is the one experience that your husband's going to say is the most important experience you've shared in all of the time you've been together?
That's easy, Mark. That'd be the birth of our first child.
Ooh, short, concise, and to the point. I like that. All right, well, have a seat. And Marge, come on up here. You heard the question. What would your hubby, your